Guess who's back? Back again. It's your boys, Ibby.
And Loosh!
Back with another one.
It's a hot dad summer.
It's a hot dad summer.
Hot diggity damn.
Hot diggity damn. Chest hair out.
Whew, I like that.
Chest hair, don't care.
Ibby looking extra, extra Lebanese, abusive father.
let's start off the episode with some stereotypes.
No, okay. Well, why not? Why not?
Oh,
you know what?
God.
Why not? You know what? Why not?
Let's do it, Mr. Floral.
Hey, man. You know how I feel about the floral. We have another relationship. Guys, I appreciate everybody hollering at us with the relationship questions. And I think what I appreciate the most about this is how intimate and personal people are getting.
Yeah.
And sharing their like really, really like intimate details
yeah,
with
like,
us.
Like I feel honored that I get to.
Yeah.
Share, well, for them to share and I, this and kind I, of information with us because they trust us. Yeah, that, feels good.
And I take it incredibly seriously. And when I go off on like, if I pop off on like a rant or if I'm saying something, I notice that I use the word I or we a lot. And oftentimes it's out of sarcasm or satire where I'm like, we can't get married if you don't convert. And I feel like maybe I should explain that. That's not what I think. It's what the culture dictates.
Yes.
Right?
I guess we got to be more clear about that
stuff. I think I do. I need to check myself a little bit more. I want people to realize that like those aren't my biases. I'm just expressing like the cultural mainstream thought.
Just like we discussed last episode about
checking.
Checking and being biased. We're like trying to be unbiased the entire time and kind of flipped, but we're in the same scenario.
We are.
But it's not intentional.
It's not. It's not. Our intentions are pure. And I just, I felt like I needed to explain that, but we have another American girl who is speaking to an Algerian prince in this case. Now, I have a little bit of experience with this couple because they were early supporters of the Loosh channel.
Okay.
And actually they met because of my content and because of I had done a Instagram story helping her. She was writing a book about the French colonization of Algeria and she needed help with it. And of course, a lot of my audience were North African.
Let's do it.
All right. So this is her. All right. We met through social media. I turned to you, so being me, for help and insight about the French-Algerian relationship and culture. You posted my question in your story, and a bunch of Algerians replied to me. And that's where he came along. His English was very advanced and could carry long conversations. We spoke regularly, daily. After 3-4 months, we confessed our feelings to one another.
Okay.
After 8 months of meeting, he proposed if we could do the Fetha.
Okay.
Now, for those who don't know, Fetha is the opening. It means the opening in Arabic. It is the first chapter of the Holy Quran. And it's typically a commitment. It's a declaration of commitment and love that you have for one another.
Yes.
And it's sort of a religious ritual.
Yeah.
Right?
In Western terms, basically means you just got engaged.
You just got engaged. But the Fetha is used, in a far more than in Eastern culture engagement is used in Western culture. Because in Eastern culture, in Western culture, there's a long dating phase. You know, they court each other for a lot longer. Yeah. Usually families are involved and, you know, it's engagement.
Yeah.
You know, but Fetha is like, all right, if we're going to do this and we want it to be halal and we want it to be pure and dignified, then we have to do it this way.
Yes.
If you're religious. And she agreed. So she continues, I'm excited about this. He told me, I want you to be my best friend, my sister, my wife, my partner in everything. Other than your sons, I want you all to myself.
Now let's clarify what he means by sister before people get confused here. Let's just... baby steps, bro. Mm-hmm. You gotta do baby steps.
Yep.
So when he says obviously sister, he means like sister in Islam.
Yeah.
Not actual sister.
Yeah, in the family, as though we have the same father being God, as a part of the religious family. So she's 33 and he's 25.
Mm.
All right. And you know, we've talked about age a lot.
We do talk about age a lot.
Yeah, it's a big
deal. Do you think it's a big gap?
No.
25 to 28, 38? 33. Sorry, 33 to
25? No.
It's an 8-year gap. Okay.
It's an 8-year gap. She has kids. And, you know, we've seen this before.
Mm-hmm.
We've seen this before, but it didn't raise any flags. The only reason why is because at 25, he's showing signs of real interest.
Yeah,
for her. To me personally, based on what I've read,
I saw the same thing. Like from what she's saying, they seem very compatible with each other.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so I think they've withstood the test of time.
Yes, regardless of the age.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. Even though she's probably she definitely is more experienced.
Mm-hmm.
Than he is.
Yes,
because of her.
She's been married. She has two kids.
Exactly.
Yeah, he hasn't been married. He has no kids.
No kids. So with that being said, they're pretty compatible, personality-wise, and
right, which is kind of hard to accomplish.
Yeah.
So I would say that's a step in the right direction, as long as he's okay with having a woman that is arguably past or nearing the end of her prime. Just in terms of marriage marketplace, already having kids, but I'm sure she probably wants to have more.
Mm-hmm.
We all know the biological clock. 40 seems to be the age where the percentages reduce significantly. Yeah. Okay. And then not just biologically, from an energy perspective, you know, at 33, you need to ask yourself, yo, like you're 25. Are you guys going to be able to compete with each other from energy?
Yeah.
Physically.
Mm-hmm.
Like kids are no joke, bro. As she knows, I'm sure. But she says, I have a friend who's Egyptian and another who's Moroccan. And both say the age difference is not a big deal. I would tend to agree. You can add Lucian Ibi Lebanese as part of your survey list of Arabs that agree to that statement. So lately, now with all of COVID and everything, Algeria is damn near impossible. It's not accessible. It's like, you know, almost wiped off the earth temporarily, you know, as we've seen with many other countries. So they decided to meet in Tunisia, but they haven't done it yet.
Okay.
Because they need to see each other soon in the next 2 months.
Like neutral grounds.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. And Tunisia, I think, has a little bit more open policies and whatnot. This time for us has been long and torturous. He expressed that when we meet, if there is any doubt that I may feel about our connection, to just tell him the truth and we can be good friends. Yes, salam.
Beautiful. Beautiful.
So these are the things that make me feel that may give me more confidence in him.
Exactly. Yes.
Because a lot of guys would say we can make it work. We got to force it. We got to, you know, no matter what, till death do us part. It's like,
you're just stating, like, you're saying quotes, bro.
Yeah, exactly.
You're not a inspirational, like, whatever speaker here, bro.
You're not a poet.
Like, just stop. Like, say it from the heart. Say what you mean. You know what I mean? Mean what you're saying. Say what you mean.
Yeah, which is what he did. Like, okay, yo, if we're gonna meet up and we're gonna do this, and you know what? He's 25, bro. He has options. She's 33. Her options are a little bit lower. You know, now, and that's the trade-off, right?
Yeah.
As we mentioned before, she's a very attractive young lady. All right, I've seen her picture. All right. He's a very attractive young man. She's not done by any means. So I'm not saying that there's any desperation between them. But for him at 25 to say that to somebody that can potentially change his life, bro, his future. Like, bro, we live in one of the best countries in the world, you and I. We live in one of the most free societies with the most opportunities.
Alhamdulillah.
And we can still argue that we've struggled. Right? I mean, put yourself in his shoes. And the fact that he said that to her is great.
It's a
I hope
great
it's
first
not reverse
step, man.
Psychology.
No, hopefully not. Hopefully not. Yeah. So far, man, it's looking very promising.
Yeah. He wants me to like him genuinely and worries that I won't. but this helped take the pressure off expecting a serious commitment when I get there. He wants to do Fetha, as you know, and invites and wants to invite all of his friends and family, which is why meeting in Tunisia is the last resort, because she wants all of her friends and family. She has dated somebody online before, and he was a great guy, but it only lasted a couple of weeks, and they weren't compatible. So the reason why I asked that was because I myself am not capable of developing, when I was single, romantic emotions
through a screen. It's like talking to a computer.
Yeah, but some people can, right? And it's like someone's relationship with a really good book.
Okay,
you know, it's like you sit there and you consume all this content, and you fall in love with a character in the book or the author, masalan, because people are able to make connections in different ways. I personally can't make that connection, which is probably why I don't read books.
Yeah. Now, when I said that, like, obviously I'm not speaking for all of people. I'm speaking on my behalf. Like, in my opinion, talking to somebody through a screen that I've never met in person, I can't fall in love. It's like literally talking to a computer. I personally can't see that happening.
Right.
But like you said, other people can.
So he wants me to experience his culture and life in Algeria. This helps me know that I'm not being kept a secret to any other lovers or girlfriends, possibly.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I like it.
Beautiful.
It's fantastic. And then I asked, as a side note, are you willing to convert to Islam? To be with him.
Solid.
Because you can't be together if you don't know.
Nope.
As mentioned in the last episode.
You're doing literally a Islamic ritual.
Right.
By doing the Fetha.
It's not a joke.
It's not a joke. So you have to convert.
Yeah. So she mentioned, actually, I converted before we expressed our interest in each other.
There you go.
So this wouldn't be a problem.
Beauty.
Mashallah. So she has taken that religious spiritual decision to join Islam. Before the fact, again, no flags being raised.
Not at all.
Right? Okay. Good. No,
like
because this, I'm looking out for her and I'm looking out for him.
Yes.
At the same time.
Now, this compared to other relationships we've talked about, like right off the bat, this is looking very promising. Like I'm not having any second thoughts or slam the brakes or pause or none of that's happening.
Good.
It's just very smooth.
Good. Yeah. So far, so good. Okay, his mother and I message frequently through WhatsApp, and I express my concerns about whether she feels this relationship is legitimate and if she accepts it and why.
Solid.
She expressed that she is concerned about his future and wants him to marry for love. She said her marriage... Okay, this is what got me right here. Listen to this. Because I was expecting her to maybe frown upon a foreign girl... But a mom wants the best for her son. So maybe she's willing to compromise some of her principles for the greater good of her son.
For her son, of course.
Which most moms would do.
Yeah.
But check what she says here. She said that her marriage was very difficult. Her husband was not very kind or warm, but asked her hand from her parents and was expected to marry. She explained to her son how to treat someone in marriage and not duplicate his father's behavior.
Wow.
Yes, salam. Right?
Now that's speaking from experience, I guess.
What limitations did the mother and the father have before getting married? None. Same culture, same country, same religion. He went, asked the parents, good to go, got the stamp of approval. Took her from her home, brought her to his home, and look what happened. She still wasn't happy because he wasn't a kind person.
Yeah, and I'm glad that she actually said that to her.
Which
she wants love for her son. You know what I mean?
Yeah, she wants love for her son, but it also shows you how even when you check off all the boxes, it can still lead to a very miserable situation.
Of course, you don't know what you're getting yourself into at that point, right?
Right.
Because hers wasn't, she didn't know her husband
right
beforehand,
but that
was an arranged marriage.
Yeah, but culturally we tend to prioritize things that don't really end up mattering, like in the long run.
Yeah,
right. Because I've seen so many amazing relationships on paper that have been absolute disasters in real life, in our culture.
This is once again another, like I made this point before, it's you got to ask all the right questions at the right time. Obviously, I'm guessing his mom didn't have the opportunity to do so because it was probably an arranged marriage. But in her case, ask all the questions, get to know the person very well, and make sure you're 100% with him as well.
Yeah.
Before you get married.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you get married, you can't change who you are.
Facts. That's facts, yeah. So the mom was worried originally when her son told her that she, the person writing in, was divorced with two young children. Rightly so. She worried how he might adjust to life with me. I told her, my situation is very peaceful. My ex-husband and I don't fight, and my children are currently living with him.
Beautiful. Love to hear that.
She said, if I was Algerian, this wouldn't be acceptable because the father of the children is usually very jealous and problematic for the new husband and relationship.
Not just Algeria, honey.
She doesn't want her son to have any distress.
That's all Arabs. Well, majority.
The majority. Yeah.
Not all Arabs. I'll take that back. But the majority. There's quite a few who get jealous and then...
It is a good observation, though, from the mom.
Yeah, it is.
I wouldn't have really thought of it just simply because if I were an ex-husband, I would not bring all of that chaos as some Arab men would.
Yeah.
Do you think your son would leave me for an Algerian when he receives his visa? She said she has an uncle that married a Danish-American woman and has never left her for an Arab. She doesn't believe her son would do this. Okay, so she has a real life example of reasons why, more than just hopes and wishes, like wishful thinking. And then I wrote, how do you feel about his replies on this topic? If you're asking his mother, it likely means you need further confirmation that he's not going to leave you.
Man.
Let's go.
Dr. Philip.
That's a cool cousins right there.
Wow.
Of course. So she replied, of course, he wouldn't ever admit to leaving me if it was his agenda. I have to have faith and trust. I ask his mother because I feel that maybe she would give me clarity and more perspective on his personality, if she would tolerate this behavior or not. All right. Fair enough.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. It's really mature.
Very, very mature.
It's this rare.
Beautiful.
I know. We're not used to this.
Like I'm getting thrown off so hard. I'm used to just like bashing people. Bro.
I'm used to like the mother said, if I don't do this, she will report me to customs.
Yeah. And then deportation. No visa, no green card. Bye bye.
Border patrol. Yeah. She'll hold me hostage in Tunisia. Yeah. But no, I think we're good. I think we've met a rational.
I love it. Like family. my meter is just like, it can't go past half to like start roasting. It's like getting stuck in
the roasting is hard.
It's
yeah.
like it's staying on the good side.
I know.
It's like wobbling.
It's frustrating, ain't it?
Yeah, it's shaking, bro. It's about to break soon.
So the mom met with her brother, so the one that married the Danish American, recently and told him about me.
Okay.
She said, my son is in love with an American. What do you think? And he told her, don't interfere with their relationship. I fear for his future here. Wow. Okay.
Beautiful.
That okay. actually sent shivers and actually made the hairs on my arm stand, bro. This is his mom's uncle saying, don't interfere with the relationship. I fear for his future here.
You're being Algerian.
Yeah.
Honestly.
Do you know like what that means for somebody to say that? It's like, yo, the kid has something good going right now. It's not my job to figure out whether or not it's real and whether or not it's love and whether 1, 2, 3. It's my job to make sure that the kid has a swing at bat.
Exactly. Exactly. You want the best for the kid.
You want him to have a fair at bat, a fair pitch, an at bat for him to hit a home run.
And with that being said, clearly, like, I guess he realized when the mom came to him and asked him this question, he realized, okay, this guy has something good going on, but she also needs clarity, just like what she said right now.
Yeah. That's interesting, eh? How the mom, the fact that the mom even spoke to her uncle shows how much it means to her as well.
Yeah. So I'm guessing
she's looking out for her son.
Exactly.
She's like, did your American Danish make you happy, bro, at the end of the day? Okay, you got a good future. Okay, you were able to leave your situation. But at the end of the day, is she a good woman? Because it's kind of like a case study for the mom. And now it's a case study for her as well, the girl writing yep. in. I said, as a side note, as a follow-up question, a better future and opportunity seems to be the priority here. Are you okay with this? And are you willing to provide this to him? It is what it is. A better future, better opportunity. Are you willing to provide this?
Well, at this point, like, if he's going to move there, it's just going to have to, at least for a little bit.
No, bro. If you sign up to a K-1 visa, let's be real here. You're responsible for 10 years.
Oh, damn.
Financially and legally.
Hello?
No. It's not Mickey Mouse Club here.
Oh, God.
Okay. It's not Disney Channel.
So she needs to have backup, like serious backup for 10 years.
Let's go.
Well, here's the hope. And the thing is, like, from what I've seen so far, I'm pretty sure he wouldn't just be a lazy little shit and just do F all because he's living off of somebody else.
So she wrote back to that question. I am okay with this. I feel she likes me, but is saddened that he would leave.
Of course.
And keeps reminding herself that it is for the best.
Of course. It's going to be tough no matter what, man.
Yeah.
You're letting your son go. You have a choice, but you don't have a choice. Let's put it that way.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's a tough milestone, but it's got to happen.
Yeah. I mean, you really empathize with these families that have to let go of their young ones.
Of course.
For a better future.
Yep.
You know, especially me, like with my son, Brahim, like I'm literally doing everything I can to build something for him here. You know, my parents came here with high hopes for me and for you with your parents. And at least we had the luxury of not being separated. But you go back another generation with my grandfather and all the kids left Lebanon. My dad was the first person to come to Canada from our family.
Thank him for that.
You know, 100 plus now family members.
Now we're all here.
But he was the first. He was like the pioneer.
That's the man right there.
Yeah, but it must have been heart-wrenching.
Oh, bro. It's so... Because the thing is, like...
And by the way, my dad didn't even do it for marriage. He did it because he was recruited as a culinary chef.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, that's amazing too.
Yeah.
Because you're coming here and you're starting a career right off the bat.
Yeah, but in a country you don't know, in a language you don't understand.
Of course.
You're 16.
There's always...
You know, 17, you know? Like, you were just... You had donkeys and cows in the field one day, and now you're like in a Western country. Yep.
Making pasta.
So he has expressed how everything should be spoken and resolved, and divorce is not an option. Ibi, how do you feel about that? Everything should be spoken and resolved, and divorce is not an option.
I like where his mindset's at. You got to say everything that's on your mind. Well, not everything that's on my mind, but everything that bothers you. Every little thing, no matter how small. Something bothers you about him, you have to say it. You have a big problem with him, something he did something that throws you off, you don't like.
But get to the part where you don't agree. That's what I really want to hear. Or maybe you do, I don't know. But divorce is not an option?
Depends on what you did. If she wants to divorce you, bro, like...
Okay.
You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It depends on the scenario. You can't just say divorce is not an option.
It's the context, yeah. My parents got divorced shortly after I was born. And at this point in my life, I'm thankful for it. Because I couldn't imagine what type of environment I would have been brought up in.
Because you like the environment that you're in now?
Well, because I realized the potential for toxicity and misery that I could have been raised under. But now, because they were separated, I was able to enjoy the best of each one separately.
Beautiful.
Do you know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean.
It's like you only stay married if you're able to be the best version of yourself.
Exactly.
As soon as you stop being the best version of yourself, then you're not doing your partner any favors. You're not doing your kids any favors.
You're not doing yourself any favors either.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I should have started with that, but you're right. I'm just thinking of like the residual effect.
Of course. Well, that's a good thing too, though, because you're not just thinking, you're not being selfish at that point. You're thinking about others, how your kids are going to be affected. as well.
Oh,
too.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I think
divorce plays a big role on children. It's insanity.
Yeah. And you want to consider them when it happens. So, of course. So yeah, I would agree. Divorce is an option, but it needs to be the absolute force majeure. It has to be the Hail Mary. It has to be the eject button. It has to be whatever term you want to use for the very last option. So I wrote as a follow-up, this is good in theory, but how do you feel about this? What if your last marriage had the same rule?
Well, damn.
Would you still be together or stuck in a miserable situation?
Surprise.
Eh?
A solid question. Because now you're putting her in a little predicament here. Now you're really making her think.
Exactly. So she said, my last marriage ended for a number of reasons. My ex-husband wasn't supportive of my goals or dreams and controlled all of our finances.
Come on.
And when we would argue, this is what ruined me. When we would argue, he would get physical. I'd fucking break him in half.
Bro, destroyed.
He believes women are beneath him and treats all women, including myself, the same. I'm not going to judge this man based off of these words. But if these words are true, then I would love for a male energy to be in the same room as him.
Your wife is your backbone. You know what? Let me put that aside for now. You're not considered a man, not only if you raise your hand on a woman, if you even think of threatening. A threat alone towards a woman doesn't make you a man.
It's not even like an exception to the rule where he treats women terribly, but his wife is like above all and a goddess. And, right? No, I was like, nah, women are shit. You're one of them. So you're shit. But for me, it's the physical part that really gets me. Like you said, even the threatening is enough. As soon as you lay a hand on a woman, and I don't want to be a hypocrite about this, okay? You know, when you grow up, you're young, you go to bars, you're out, nightlife, whatever. And females, when they're inebriated, intoxicated, the liquid courage, they want to lay hands. And you let them lay hands, but there are defense mechanisms that you can do to get them off of you at the same time, right? And the sheer power of your defense can be considered as offense in their eyes, right? I once had a girl jump on my back and she was scratching my face. This was our grad party turned into massive bar brawl. All right, tables, chairs, pool sticks.
TLC, bro. Tables, ladders, and chairs.
Tables, ladders, and chairs. Everything, the whole nine. It spilled out to the outside. You know, we had 35 Arabs against 50 non-Arabs. We were in the wrong part of town. I'll tell you that right now. You know what? The bar was called the British.
Okay.
Let me just put it that way.
You're like...
We were a little bit too tan.
You're not in the wrong part of town, bro. You're outside of town at this point.
I'm in another country.
You're somewhere else.
Neither here nor there. But she jumped on me. I peeled her off of my back.
Like a scab.
Like a banana peel. I peeled her off my back and I threw her off of me. There may or may not have been a brick wall 3 feet away from me. Right?
That you saw or did not see?
I didn't see.
Okay.
No, I didn't see. But anyways, and that's what I'm saying is that as soon as you lay hands offensively on a woman, you've lost your ability to communicate. You've become an animal at that point. Because what separates us from animals is our rational thought and our ability to rationalize and communicate in a peaceful manner. And knowing that you're physically stronger, it's a fact. It's a biological fact. And for you to still lay hands on something so delicate. Now, if she wants to become an MMA fighter and she wants to throw hands... If she wants to act like one, aye, mama, let's go. Toe-to-toe, 12 rounds. Here we go. You know what I mean? Bare knuckle. Jab, jab, right hook, cross, uppercut, Hadouken. But that's for the women that want to act like men.
Oh, my God.
All right? But in this case, I'm sure she wasn't.
Jeez.
I've seen a picture of her. She's a very small, petite, you know, attractive young lady, and I just don't see it.
I guess that kind of,
you know, so, not like a Butch Cassidy type girl.
Yeah. With I a guess shaved head. That probably hyped up her ex-husband even more. The fact that he's probably like three times her size.
Right. Right.
Thinking he's Mr. Macho Man.
So I continue here. He loves his children. So we're talking about her ex. He loves his children, but is very controlling and finds my dreams silly. Wow. It took me a few years to save money and leave. Wow. Imagine that, eh? Imagine a woman plotting to leave you and entertaining you temporarily until she can have the financial means to leave you. Imagine that. What does that say to you as a man, knowing that a woman did that to you?
You don't belong in the house. You belong in the garbage.
So continuing on, he's not westernized. So I said, this is huge. How do you feel about this? Do you think the culture shock would be big if he ever moved to the West? She said, I believe it would be. But I also believe he would absolutely love it. I would introduce him to all my friends and go to as many places as we can. All with time. These Beautiful. Things need to be approached with grace and patience so he's not overwhelmed. Bravo. Very good.
Did you ask, is there a language barrier? How is his English?
Advanced.
Really?
Yeah.
Solid.
It's Beautiful. Advanced. That's why they actually developed it.
Okay, I'm guessing same thing probably with his mom too, since they're texting.
Well, they may be using the translator app. No, okay. I don't think his mom speaks English. I don't think, I'm assuming. But with today's technology on WhatsApp, you can, you know, Google Translate, boom, boom, boom.
Done deal.
You know, big paragraphs at a time, you know? When he and I argue, it's mostly about him bottling up emotions. I ask what's wrong and he closes up. I push and get angry. I feel I've expressed so much and got angry when I don't get the same in return right away. I've learned to give him space and time, and eventually he opens up a day or two later. Yeah, and that's very common with men and women.
Okay. With that being said, here's what's going to need to happen. Well, I'm not going to tell you what to do, but my opinion, when a man bottles up, that means he needs space. Once he cools down, he'll come and talk to you. With that being said, don't push him. Don't be aggressive. Don't force him to tell you what's wrong, because all at that point you're doing is pushing him away even more. After he comes back and starts talking to you again, calm, kind manner, tell him, please, I don't like being out of the picture when something is wrong, because maybe it makes you feel like you're the problem. You got to express all that stuff. But then again, there's a way to do so as well.
And it also speaks volumes on his maturity when he, at 25, understands his limitations and understands that he needs time as to not be in the moment and emotional, which is huge. I'm 36 and I've only just developed those barriers.
And don't shape him to be what you want either. Like, don't, like with what she just said, she pushes him to tell her what's wrong. Don't do that. Like tell him how you feel and how you feel about the situation. He'll meet you halfway.
Yeah. And also he's doing it for your own good. Like, it's a defense mechanism.
Yeah. He doesn't
it's like, you don't want to hear what I have to say right now.
Like, yeah. It's not going to come out the way I want it to come out.
Exactly.
And I'm going to regret it later on.
Right. So I followed up with, you're both operating on two different emotional spectrums. As an older woman with kids and marriage history, you're very much ahead of this younger man, whose culture already frowns upon men being emotional and dramatic.
Facts.
Right?
My God.
She replied back, I'm aware I will have to keep patience and understanding with him within all realms of this dynamic. I want to help him grow, and I want a man who's going to be faithful and protect me. And have amazing and one that I have amazing chemistry with. This is rare, which is why I'm going through all these risks. I've only ever had a connection this intense many years ago, and I want to find out how it really is once again.
Wow.
Yeah, that's heavy.
Very heavy. Very well put together. Like I said, man, she's very mature.
Yeah, they both are. And she said, you know, it's usually about the same issue of the borders keeping us apart. Like, this is a distance conversation that they're having, argument, usually. When we get excited from month to month thinking it's coming soon, we're both depressed and tired, but refuse to let the other go because we love each other. We laugh and cry and share everything under the moon, sun, and galaxy.
So cute.
It's like love it.
It's a cute little love story.
Yeah. I've been betrayed and cheated on by men my age and much older, as I've told you. I've never dated or been with a man 8 years younger than me. I've thought about this from so many angles. It is heavy. And like I said, there's a trade-off happening here. And in America, in the West, you would have to worry about a 25-year-old young buck.
Oh, yeah.
You would. He's wild and free. What do you mean?
They love the freedom here.
What do you mean?
Love it.
And it's just, it's not even a good or bad thing. It's just fact. You know, like, yeah, he's going to explore. Do you want to be a part of that exploration? Or do you want to be the destination?
That's what you're saying. Do you want to be the test?
Yeah.
Or do you want to be the final result?
Exactly. So, you know, as usual, you know, I asked the usual questions, work experience and education and stuff. And again, as we see time and time again from these countries, it's very limited, but it seems like the passion and energy and motivation is there for him to make something work. Plus, you know, I told her, and as she knows, leverage your network where you are, right? So in this case, she's from Texas. Big state. If I ever moved to the States, it would be Texas, bro.
All the way.
All right. And she said that there's a massive North African and Arab community where she is.
Oh, yeah.
So leverage that. That's great. But the most important question that I want to touch on and end this podcast with was, are you willing to have more children and resubmit to another man?
Okay.
Because everything else I think is secondary.
Yeah, yeah.
If we can't get past this.
Facts.
Right?
Facts.
Forget the borders, forget COVID, forget education, all that stuff.
This has to be first nature.
He's expressed how enthusiastic he is about having children. He wants a little girl that looks just like me, he says. My eyes, my skin. He wants two children at the very least. Whoa, family man. At 25, he's a family man. Right?
Hits you on the heart, bro.
It's tugging at the heartstrings. After his grandmother passed in January, I had a vision about this little girl. And I wanted to name her after his mother, Sohad.
Wow.
I asked if this was appropriate. I felt it would touch his mother's heart, and I already love her so much. And he told me a few days prior, his mother approached him and asked him to please name his daughter after her. His mother had an amazing relationship with her parents. She misses them every day. I don't believe this was a coincidence.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. Wow.
I'm preparing for this transition. I know, I got shivers, bro. I got shivers. I mean, she had a dream, a vision, and before that, his like, mom had already approached him about it.
If this doesn't show you that it's meant to be, then I don't know what does, man.
And inshallah, they get blessed with you know, baby girl, Sohad. I'm preparing for this transition as much as anyone can. I'm learning so much about the culture, the cuisine, the language. My goal is to turn our home into an Algerian haven. Yes, salam. Yes, salam.
Fi romantique.
Yeah, hayati. The goal is to find a medium, the best of both worlds, integrated as one, a perfect balance. I've asked him, get this, I've asked him, do I belong to you as a possession? He said, don't take this the wrong way, but yes. Not in the material kind of way, but you belong to me in the sense that I have to protect you.
Wow. Round of applause for
Now, third wave feminists, I know you guys are sitting alone, miserable in your one bedroom apartment.
Trigger fingers right there.
Wondering why no men will ever talk to you.
Yep, but start typing.
But you're free and you're not possessed.
Mm-hmm. Fingers on the keyboard as we speak.
Just calm yourselves if you're listening or watching. All right. This isn't for you. Go away. So you're a possession in the sense of your mind. To celebrate, to lift up, to cherish, to value, to love, and above all, to protect.
What more do you want?
Against all threats.
What more do you want?
And I promise you, most women want that. They love that. It's music to their ears. They would just want to build a family.
That's it.
They want to be happy. They want to be protected. They want to be supported. Not rocket science. I don't know why. I don't know why in the past 10 years we've complicated the shit out of this.
I don't understand. I really don't. I wish I knew.
It's good.
They just need a shoulder to lean on, man. That's it.
Women?
Yeah.
they need a shoulder to lean on, and they need another shoulder to body slam anything that threatens them in any way.
Fucking just become Dwayne the Rock Johnson around the spot, bro.
Like the Hulk.
Done. Hulk smash.
And then she says, how do you think she took it when he said that? She said, I find this incredibly endearing. I've never had someone care where I'm at or where I'm going or who I'm with. Even though this is not popular amongst today's culture in the West, I want to be a homemaker.
Well, you should feel...
I want to be a homemaker. This is an American Texan young lady who has been married and has two kids and is ready to start another family with the men that she loves. I want to be a homemaker. And the sooner you admit that with no guilt from other women that are actually trying to abuse their other fellow women that think differently, as soon as you relinquish your connection with that school of thought, being third wave feminism, and you admit what you really want in life, yes, and you're floating on a river at that point.
You're literally a princess becoming a queen.
Wow.
You're a blooming flower.
Wow. Wow.
You're a caterpillar.
Wow.
Going to your cocoon, becoming a butterfly.
Wow. Wow.
I'm becoming a poet here myself.
It's like, you know, the sunflower when the sun is up and then it turns, you know, sunflowers, they turn and they face the sun. And then the Lion King song starts.
Yeah, yeah.
A man knows his role, a woman knows her role, and you watch the beautiful balance take place. This the energy.
We need more of this,
the
man.
The synchronization. Yep.
We need more of this.
Mashallah.
The world needs more women like her.
And there more are men like him. I think there's a silent majority out there, bro.
There is.
It's good, though. I want to master Algerian cuisine. I want to make our home a haven for the man that I love and our children. I want to cook and be as maternal as I can. I didn't quite have this growing up. I want to be a good wife, his best friend, and great mother. I've adopted Islam slowly before we confessed our interest in one another, and he's helped me when I've asked for direction or explanation about the religion. I don't mind dressing modestly, although I may not always wear hijab, because it's my choice, and he understands this. He's not a very pushy person. He respects what I have to say and my feelings. We both know immense changes will take place within ourselves going forward. He understands that all things take time. I'm from a different culture, and he is also.
Beautiful.
I mean,
like, the thing is, like, she's hit all the right marks by herself.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, her entire process up to meeting him was accomplished by herself. Like, she didn't, it wasn't forced on her. Islam, the whole nine, her mentality of thinking, her personality. It's all her, which is beautiful, which means absolutely
it's
stunning.
It's real.
Yeah, it's perfect.
Yeah, and I mean, for him, it's like, yo, all I'm thinking is, bro, like, don't fuck this up.
100%.
You know, like, stay focused. You found a really good one. And in her case, she found a really good one as well. Again, like, there's no flags here. And I appreciate her writing into us and allowing us to share her story with the world. The only, if I had to nitpick, if I had to be super, super, super strict on this thing, is the only two things that I'm worried about is the 8-year gap.
Okay.
Kind of. And then the culture shock of American culture.
I agree with the culture shock a little bit, but not that much, just because, like we said before, there's a lot of Arabs in Texas.
Yeah.
So,
yep.
It wouldn't be too bad. Like, there'll be a part of his culture there already.
You got to find those cultural havens.
And plus, she's willing to let her friends
integrate,
show him around, everything.
Yep. Get him in the zone.
And they're Yep. Same culture.
And he hasn't shown any signs of control. Remember the last person we had?
Which is amazing.
He hasn't told her to stop doing things or to stop following people or...
You want to know why?
Why?
Because she's perfect the way she is. Mm. Nothing needs to change mm-hmm. about her.
Yeah, I hope...
She's already the full package.
And I hope, and I appreciate you speaking on his behalf, but I hope he's not doing that as to not create any issues
until
he gets to the destination, right?
I hope so too. But so far, so good.
So far, so good.
That's it, man.
Wow. Okay. I mean, thank you. Amazing relationship. Send us your situation, your questions, your anything that you're going through. You know, the cousins, we have your back. We're gonna sit back. We're going to look at it thoroughly, and we're gonna talk about it together. So that we can keep breaking down those cultural barriers. Because we are
the cool cousins. And you can talk to us more than you can talk to your parents.